بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حديث 642 وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال اللهم ارحم المحلقين قالوا والمقصرين يا رسول الله قال في الثالثة والمقصرين متفق عليه. From Ibn Umar, he says that the Prophet said, O Allah, have mercy on those who shave their heads. And the companions replied, and also on those who shorten their hair. But the Prophet repeated what he said, and the companions repeated it again. Then on the third time, the Prophet said, and have mercy to those who shorten their hair. Muttafaqun alayh. There's a difference of opinion as to when this hadith was said. Some scholars say this happened during the year of Al-Hudaybiyah, when the Muslims had to exit their ihram. And other scholars say this happened during the farewell tawaf. But in any case, the ruling is the same, which is to say that shaving off the head is better and more virtuous than shortening the hair, although both are permissible, because the Prophet made dua for both types, but he made more dua for those who shave their head. And what is correct here is that shaving or shortening the hair are from the wajibat of the Hajj. You must do them. If you don't, you have to sacrifice an animal. And we say these are acts of worship because the Prophet made dua for mercy. So there is a virtue in this. And if there is a virtue in an act, then it can't just be a normal everyday act. It has to be an act of worship. So this is part of the rituals of the Hajj, hence it is an act of worship. As for shaving the head completely, then this is only for the men and not for the women. And the narration for this is coming up. But if you are performing a tamattu' and you finish your umrah, then we say that if there is not too much time left between the Umrah and the Hajj, then it is better for you to shorten the hair. So at least that way you have some hair left to shave off when you make your tahallul from the ihram of the Hajj. Further evidence that shaving the head or shortening the hair is an act of worship is found in Surah Al-Fath, Ayah 27. لَتَدْخُلُنَّ الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ آمِنِينَ مُحَلِّقِينَ رُؤُوسَكُمْ وَمُقَصِّرِينَ لَا تَخَافُونَ. Allah is saying that He shall fulfill the true vision which He gave the Prophet, that the Muslims will be entering the Al-Masjid Al-Haram, some having shaved their head and some having cut short their hair, and they will not be in any fear. So the point is that Allah Jalla wa Ala is praising these people, and if there is praise, it means that this is an act of worship. And this hadith also shows us that virtuous actions are of varying levels. So not every virtuous action is of the same virtue as another virtuous action. So here we find that shaving the head is more virtuous than cutting the hair short. The other and weaker opinion on this issue is that shaving or cutting the hair short is not a nusuk or not a ritual of Hajj. Rather, it is just something for you to leave the ihram by. In the same way that eating and drinking is not part of the fasting, so it's not an act of worship which is part of the fasting, but it is there to exit you from the state of fasting. So based upon this opinion, if you did not shave or cut short, then there is nothing upon you because it is not from the wajibat of the Hajj. But the better opinion is that it is from the wajibat and an act of worship. And the shaving or the cutting will not suffice you until you do it to the whole head. So if you're going to cut short the hair, you have to cut short all of the hair of the head. And if you're going to shave, you have to shave the whole head, not just part of it. And this is the madhab of Abu Hanifa, Malik and Ahmad. So when you release yourself from the ihram, you just have to cut short the hair of the head or shave the head. You don't have to touch any other hair of the body. Except that some ulama have also said it is good for you to remove the hair of the other parts of the body, like the moustache, the armpit hair and the pubic hair. And also to cut short the nails. And they say that Abdullah ibn Umar used to do this. Although, we don't have any specific evidence from the Prophet ﷺ. The wisdom behind shaving or cutting short the hair is showing that you are lowly and humble before Allah Jalla wa Ala, and an outward display of your slaveship to Him. So therefore, shaving the head is better than cutting short the hair because it is more of an outward display of your slaveship than cutting the hair short. So this is why the Prophet made dua more for those who shave the head than those who simply cut short. Also from the wisdoms is cleanliness, because during the Hajj there could well be some dirt or dust which has come onto the head. So if you cut short or shave your head, then this will remove the dirt and the dust. And this is better because you shave or shorten before you make the tawaf al-ifadah, if you want to do it in accordance with the strict sunnah. And so you will then enter the Masjid al-Haram in a clean state. And this is what is required when you enter the masajid. Allah says, يَا بَنِي آدَمَ خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. O Banu Adam, take your adornments to every masjid. So you should be in a clean and pure state when you enter the masjid. And so what is the latest time for you to shave the head? You must not do it past the end of Dhul-Hijjah, because Dhul-Hijjah is from the months of the Hajj. And because the shaving or the shortening is from the rituals of the Hajj, you are not allowed to go beyond the months of the Hajj. And if you did this intentionally, this would be haram upon you. Al-Hafidh mentions this narration after the narrations of pelting the Jamrah. But we need to note that the order in which the Prophet did it was that on the 10th he pelted the Jamratul Aqaba. After that he performed the animal sacrifice. And then he shaved the head. So if you want to do it in the order of the Sunnah, which is the better way, then you would sacrifice the animal and then shave the head. Although the order in which you do things on Yawm al-Nahr is flexible, as we will see in the narration coming up. Hadith 643. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ليس على النساء حلق وإنما على النساء التقصير. رواه أبو داود بإسناد حسن. From Ibn Abbas, the Prophet said, women don't have to shave the head, women have to cut the hair short. The hadith is sahih. So we've said before that shaving the head is specific for the men. As for the woman, shaving the head will look very masculine, and the women are not allowed to look masculine. So rather what they do is that they cut their hair short. But how much do they cut short? The ulama say they cut short to a fingertip's worth. And remember, you must cut all of the hair short, equally, not just one part of the head and leave out the other. And it makes no difference whether the woman is performing the Umrah or the Hajj, she cuts her hair short to a fingertip length. So what about this idea of a woman having a haircut then, just generally speaking, not specifically in the Hajj, just generally? We say she's allowed to cut her hair short, but if she does it so it begins to look like the head of a man, so the hair is so short, then this needs to be discouraged, because a woman is not allowed to imitate a man. And if you observe, those jobs which are very masculine in nature, they turn the woman masculine. So you will find that these women normally cut their hair short and they look masculine. You would often find this in political jobs, that the woman normally begins to look very masculine because the job by its nature is very masculine. Similarly, if a woman is bodybuilding, she begins to look masculine. All of this is haram. So therefore we find there are some jobs which are not suited for the woman because it ruptures her natural femininity. And this is something which the Sharia always takes into account, the true nature of the man and the woman, and it assigns particular roles for them which are in tune with their nature, be it masculinity or femininity. Also we say that if a woman was to have a haircut and it makes her look like a prostitute, because it could be that in a particular area, prostitutes have a particular type of haircut which allures the other men in. So if she's going to look like some dissolute type of woman, then this is haram, because you're not allowed to imitate the evil people. If she's going to have a haircut which will make her stand out from the crowd, then this is from the libas al-shuhra, from those types of clothing which make you stand out from the rest, and this is haram. And so the haircuts also enter into this category, something to make you stick out from the rest of the crowd. And whoever wears the libas al-shuhra, then on Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah will clothe him with a clothing of humiliation. So these are the haram types of haircuts. The makruh type of haircut is if she cuts one part of the head and not the other, which is called al-qaza, such that some parts appear to be shortened and other parts appear to be longer. And this qaza applies to both men and women. Also, if she cuts her hair short so that it loses her feminine beauty, then this is also makruh. So if this is feared, then it would be a good idea to consult her husband, because the wife should be alluring to her husband. But other than these types of haircuts, the woman is allowed to cut her hair and have a particular hairstyle. Hadith 644. وعن عبد الله بن عمر بن العاص رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقف في حجة الوداع فجعلوا يسألونه فقال رجل لم أشعر فحلقت قبل أن أذبح قال اذبح ولا حرج وجاء آخر فقال لم أشعر فنحرت قبل أن أرمي قال ارمي ولا حرج فما سئل يومئذ عن شيء قدم ولا أخر إلا قال افعل ولا حرج متفق عليه. From Abdullah ibn al-As, he says that the Prophet stood during the farewell Hajj and the people came and started to ask him questions. And this was on the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah. So a man comes and he says, I did not realize I shaved my head before I sacrificed the animal. And the Prophet said, sacrifice your animal and there is no sin upon you. Another man says, I did not realize I sacrificed the animal before I pelted the jamrah. And the Prophet said, pelt the jamrah and there is no sin upon you. And Abdullah says that on that day the Prophet was not asked about anything which was brought forward or delayed, except that the Prophet would say, go and do it and there is no problem. Muttafaqun alayh. We can take from this narration that every Hajj group should have an alim or a scholar who will be at the service of the group, giving them the fatwa and guiding them whenever they need to be guided on any issue. This narration is taking place on the Yawm al-Nahr, on the 10th, and this is a busy old day because what you have to do is, first of all, you leave Muzdalifah just before sunrise and you arrive at Mina after sunrise and you stone the Jamaratul Aqaba. After that, you sacrifice your animal. If you're performing the tamattu' or the qiran and you are not from the area of the haram, thereafter you either shave or shorten. Then after that you perform the tawaf al-ifada. And then after that, if you have not performed the sa'i already, if you're doing the qiran, then you would have to perform the sa'i after that. So this would mainly apply to those who are performing the tamattu'. So these are four actions, potentially five, which you have to perform. And this is the order in which to perform it, meaning the sunnah order. However, this order, according to most scholars, is not wajib, and you can perform all of these five actions in any order you wish. If somebody ruptures this order out of forgetfulness, then we have an ijma' that there is no sin upon him, and he can carry on doing his actions in the prescribed order. The difference of opinion comes when a person deliberately ruptures this order. But we can take from this hadith that the sharia is flexible. So if somebody makes a mistake out of forgetfulness, then the sharia is flexible in this issue and it does not punish people on account of their forgetfulness. What about this scenario? If a person is performing the qiran or the ifrad and he did not perform the tawaf al-qudum, so when he entered the state of ihram from the miqat, he went straight to Mina and he started the hajj there. On the 10th now, does he have to perform the tawaf al-qudum, the arrival tawaf, and the tawaf al-ziyarah, or will one tawaf suffice? The answer is one tawaf will suffice, because the tawaf al-qudum is like the tahiyyatul masjid in any other masjid. So if you were to come into a masjid and you have to perform the two rakat of tahiyyatul masjid, but you combine that intention with praying the sunnah of the salatul fajr in the masjid, then you do not need to pray the tahiyyatul masjid and then after pray the sunnah of the fajr. Rather, you simply pray the sunnah of the fajr and this would suffice you for the tahiyyatul masjid, because it holds true that you have prayed two rakat before you sit down in the masjid. And so the same thing applies here. You do not have to perform two tawafs on the Yawm al-Nahr if you have not performed the tawaf al-qudum, and that the tawaf al-ziyarah or the tawaf al-ifadah would suffice you. As for the tawaf al-ziyarah or the tawaf al-ifadah, then you don't have to perform this on the 10th. Rather, you can delay it if you want to, even intentionally delay it, but you're not allowed to delay it until after the month of Dhul-Hijjah, except if you have a genuine excuse. Maybe you are injured and you have to spend some time in the hospital, or perhaps a woman is in a postnatal bleeding and she can't enter the masjid, or something of that nature. But because the tawaf al-ifadah is from the rites of the Hajj, it is not allowed to be delayed until after Dhul-Hijjah, because the Hajj is performed in the months of the Hajj, which are, of course, Shawwal, Dhul-Qa'dah and Dhul-Hijjah, the last 3 months of the Islamic calendar. So with regards to the order of the actions as we gave, there is an ijma' of the scholars that this is the recommended order and the order in which the Prophet did it on this day. And the Prophet said, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ, take from me your Hajj rituals. They also agree that it is permissible if a person is ignorant of this order or he was forgetful and he ruptures this order, then there is no sin upon him, and the evidence is this hadith which we are discussing right now. However, what about the one who deliberately ruptures this order, so he knew the ruling and he was not forgetful, and neither was he forced into performing it in the opposing order? Most scholars say that still there is no sin upon him, and he is allowed to do this. And they take the evidence from this hadith that the Prophet did not mind the people rupturing the order in which the Prophet did it. These ulama take their evidence from another wording of this hadith in the Sahihain, in which the Prophet is asked that I shave the head before I sacrifice the animal. And the Prophet says, sacrifice the animal and there is no sin upon you. So this man does not say that I did not realize. He simply says that I shave the head before sacrificing. So these ulama say that this narration does not mention that this person was forgetful or he did not realize. The Hanafiya say, no, this narration, which we have here in Bulugh al-Maram, which is another wording from the Sahihain, it mentions the fact that this person says, I did not realize. He says, لم أشعر. So this is making a restriction. So this hadith is muqayyad, and the other one is mutlaq, or absolute, which does not make a restriction. So they say that in usul al-fiqh, you carry the mutlaq on the muqayyad, and so you make the restriction. And this is well known from the rules of usul al-fiqh, and we have discussed this in our presentation there. So they say that if the person is forgetful or he is ignorant of the ruling, then there is no sin upon him. Otherwise, the original ruling is, the Prophet has ordered, take from me your Hajj rituals. So therefore, it is wajib to perform it in this order. So if we go by the Hanafiya opinion, then if you deliberately rupture this order, then you have to sacrifice an animal because you missed out a wajib action, which is the order. Upon the majority opinion, there is no sin upon you. And the majority opinion is the correct one, because we find authentically reported in the Sunan, a man asks the Prophet, سَعَيْتُ قَبْلَ أَنْ أَطُوفَ. I performed the sa'i before I made the tawaf. And the Prophet said, perform your tawaf and there is no sin upon you. So here we find that on this day, you can even perform the sa'i before the tawaf. As for this hadith, Shaykh al-Albani has graded it to be sahih, as opposed to some ulama who say it is weak. Other ulama have said that this sa'i is pertaining to the sa'i which the qarin or the mufrid performs after he makes the tawaf al-qudum. It is not talking about the sa'i which the mutamatti' performs after the tawaf al-ifadah. So based upon this, they say that you have to perform the tawaf al-ifadah before the sa'i on the 10th. But we say no, this is not correct. Rather, what is apparent from the hadith is that this man is talking about the sa'i which he performed after the tawaf al-ifadah. And this is what is apparent from the context of the hadith. So based upon this, you are allowed to perform the sa'i before you perform the tawaf al-ifadah. And that there is this flexibility on the 10th day of Dhul-Hijjah. And so based upon this now, if the order was wajib, then the Prophet would have told him, no, it doesn't matter whether you forgot or were ignorant, go back, perform your tawaf, and then perform the sa'i, because the order is important. Sure, you're not sinful because you forgot or were ignorant. However, this does not excuse you from missing out a wajib act, which in this case is the order. But the point is, the Prophet did not tell him this. Therefore, we know that it makes no difference whether you ruptured the order intentionally or unintentionally. And likewise, in the wording of this hadith of the chapter, the Prophet is saying, إِفْعَلْ وَلَا حَرَجْ. Do it and there is no problem. So the way to understand this is that if you make this mistake in the future, then you can do this and there is no problem upon you. So the Prophet is saying that there is no sin upon you today, nor will there be any sin upon you if you were to repeat this order, which is contrary to the order of the Prophet, in the future. And also needs to be pointed out that if you're performing the tamattu', then you would need to perform the sa'i after the tawaf. And if you performed it before, then like we said before, there is no problem with this, because on this day, it is flexible. And we have the authentic evidence in the Sunan, which we have just quoted, and we also replied against the arguments which the other ulama throw to refute our viewpoint. And this sa'i is one sa'i, even if you're performing the qiran, because there is no difference between the qiran and the ifrat, like we said before. So you don't have to perform two sa'is, one for the hajj and one for the umrah, if you're performing the qiran. However, if you're performing the qiran or the ifrat, and you perform the sa'i after the tawaf al-qudum, then you do not need to perform the sa'i after the tawaf al-ifadah, because that sa'i which you performed after the tawaf al-qudum is the sa'i for your hajj, meaning the wajib sa'i, or even a rukn, as some ulama put it, on a rukn level, so that your hajj is not complete until you perform the sa'i. As for if you're performing tamattu', then no doubt you would have to perform the sa'i after the tawaf al-ifadah. As for the sa'i you performed after your first tawaf, then this was the sa'i for the umrah, not the sa'i for the hajj. If you're performing the qiran or the ifrad, then after your tawaf al-qudum, you don't have to perform the sa'i, and you can delay it until you perform it after the tawaf al-ifadah. But it is better for you to perform the sa'i after the tawaf al-qudum, because the congestion will be much less. And you will not have to perform the sa'i along with all these other people who are performing sa'i because they are performing the tamattu'. The Prophet, after performing the tawaf al-ifadah, drank from the water of Zamzam. And this is a recommendation. The Prophet ﷺ said, authentically, ma'u zamzam lima shuriba lah. The water of Zamzam is for whatever it is drunk for. So before drinking this water, you make your niyyah for whatever you're drinking it for. And it has been reported that some of the hadith scholars would drink this water and they would make the intention for a strong memory, because when you're a hadith scholar, you need a strong memory to memorize many a hadith. But you can drink it for other purposes, like maybe healing from an ailment or anything else. The Muslim will drink to his fill, and the munafiq though would not, because the zamzam water is not sweet type of water, rather it is quite salty, so it is not a delicious type of water. So therefore the munafiq is not going to find it very appealing, because he does not have any faith in his heart anyway, whereas the Muslim is not going to care whether it is sweet water or salty water. He knows this is blessed water and he's going to drink to his fill. And to this effect we have an authentic hadith in Sunan Ibn Majah, where the Prophet said, "Inna ayata ma bayna ahli al-iman wal-nifaq at-tadallu' min ma'i zamzam." The sign or the difference between the people of iman and that of nifaq is that the people of iman drink much from the water of zamzam, so they are very familiar with it, whereas the people of nifaq are going to be averse to the water of zamzam simply because it does not taste very nice. Hadith 645. وعن المسور بن مخرمة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نحر قبل أن يحلق وأمر أصحابه بذلك رواه البخاري. From المسور بن مخرمة, he says that the Prophet sacrificed the camel before he shaved his head, and he ordered his companions to do that. البخاري reported it. So we take from this hadith then that the correct order on the 10th is that you sacrifice the animal first and then you shave the head, as this is what the Prophet did. But we said before that it is permissible to do it in any order you want, and there is a logical reason for doing it in any order as well, which is that if everybody had to do the same thing at the same time, this will cause unbearable congestion, especially if you have more than 2 million people performing the Hajj. So in addition to the evidence from the text, we have a logical argument to support the fact that you can do these actions on the 10th in any order you wish. As for this particular narration, it is taking place when the Muslims were prevented from performing the Umrah in the year of Al-Hudaybiyah, which is the 6th year. And so the Prophet released himself from the Ihram, and he did this by sacrificing the animal which he brought along and also shaving his head. So this is how you release yourself from the Ihram if you are detained, and the chapter on being detained is coming up. But the Treaty of Hudaybiyah is an example where the Prophet and the companions were detained by the Quraysh. But we can take from this narration that if you are detained and you cannot complete the Hajj, then you are allowed to exit the Ihram, but on the condition that first you sacrifice an animal and also you shave the head, and you can shorten the hair if you want to. As Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the Qur'an, فَإِنْ أُحْصِرْتُمْ فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. And if you are detained, then you must sacrifice whatever is easy for you from an animal. The ayah does not mention shaving the head, but we know this from this narration, as this is what the Prophet did when he was detained in the 6th year. But does he have to do it in this order? So does he have to sacrifice the animal first and then shave the head? Or do we say that the issue is flexible just like the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah? We say no, you have to do it in this order, because the Prophet is giving an order to the companions to do it in this order. So we say you don't shave your head first and then sacrifice the animal, rather you sacrifice the animal first, then shave the head. As far as the sacrifice which you make on the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah, so this is when you're obviously performing the Hajj, then the sacrifice you make for the Tamattu' or the Qiran is a sacrifice of thanksgiving. So you are allowed to eat from it, and you feed others as well, as Allah Jalla wa'ala says, فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا وَأَطْعِمُوا الْقَانِعَ وَالْمُعْتَرِ. So eat from it and feed the poor people who ask and those poor people who don't ask. As for if you have to sacrifice an animal because you have to shave the head during your ihram or because you left out a wajib act, then you are not allowed to eat from this animal and you have to feed it to the poor people. Because this sacrifice now is a sacrifice to make up for a loss, not a sacrifice of thanksgiving. So as for the sacrifice of the thanksgiving for the tamattu' or the qiran, then this is much like the udhiyah which the Muslims celebrate all over the world on the day of Eid. So they would eat from their sacrificial animal and they would give to others as well. But if you are going on Hajj and you are going to sacrifice the animal, then it is not reported from any of the companions nor from the Prophet that they sacrifice the animal for the Hajj and also they perform the udhiyah, which is the sacrificial animal for the day of Eid. They did not combine between the two. It's either one or the other, because the hadith for the Hajj takes the place of the udhiyah. As for this idea of performing the sacrifice for the qarin or the mutamattir, then this is an imitation of what Ibrahim alayhi salam had to do with his only son Ismail. And this act was so beloved to Allah Jalla wa'ala that he has required all of us to perform the same thing, much in the same way as the running of Hajar, the mother of Ismail, between the Safa and Marwa was so beloved to Allah Jalla wa Ala that he has ordered us to imitate her. With regards to the sacrifice of the tamattu or the qiran, then the ulama say it is not permissible to not sacrifice this animal and in place of it just to pay the money to the poor in charity, because this is a type of playing with the sharia. Rather, it is obligatory, if you are able to do so, to buy the animal and sacrifice it. Or you can have it done on your behalf. But to pay charity with the equivalent value instead is not permissible. And the days of sacrifice for the tamattu' are the 10th, 11th, 12th and 13th. And some scholars even allow it after these days, but we say it is better to stick to these days, because all of these days are days of eating and drinking and the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. As for sacrificing the animal for the tamattu' or the qiran, then this can be done in Mina, but it can also be done in Mecca or any place in the haram. Hadith 646. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا رميتم فقد حل لكم الطيب وكل شيء إلا النساء. رواه أحمد وأبو داود وفي إسناده ضعف. From Aisha, the Prophet said, when you have stoned the jamrah, then perfume and everything becomes halal for you except women. The hadith is sahih. This hadith tells us that the first exiting of the ihram takes place after you stone the Jamratul Aqaba. And when this happens, everything becomes halal for you, except having intercourse with your wives and touching them passionately. This will only become halal for you after you completely remove yourself from the ihram, which is when you pelt the jamra, shave your head, and you perform the tawaf al-ifadah, along with the sa'i if you have not done so. And we're talking about the sa'i of the hajj, not the sa'i of the umrah, if you're performing tamattu'. Once you've done all of that, then you become completely removed from the ihram and everything becomes halal for you. So there are no restrictions on the clothing, perfume, hunting the animals in the hill. Of course, you're never allowed to hunt the animals in the haram. So the point is you become completely free from the ihram and the restrictions are removed. But we have a difference of opinion here, because some scholars will use this hadith to say that the first exiting takes place after you stone the Jamratul Aqaba. The other opinion is that the first tahallul, or the first exiting of the ihram, takes place after the stoning of the jamrah and the shaving of the head. So two things, not just one. And the evidence for this is the statement of Aisha in the Sahih. She said, I would put the perfume on the Prophet for his ihram, meaning before he went into the state of ihram. And this is obviously putting the perfume on the body, not on the clothes. And she says, also I would put the perfume for his hil, meaning his exiting of the ihram, before he would make tawaf around the house. But we know that the Prophet performed the tawaf al-ifadah after the stoning and shaving his head. So this would now tell us that Aisha put the perfume on the Prophet after the Prophet pelted the jamrah and shaved his head. Otherwise, Aisha would have said that I would put the perfume on the Prophet for his hil before he shaved his head. She would not have said before he made the tawaf. So what appears to be the case now, and the safer opinion, is that your first tahallul takes place after the stoning and the shaving of the head. So two things, not just one, even though this hadith is telling us that it is just one. Note here, after the first tahallul, you are allowed to enter into a marriage contract. You are just not allowed to have intercourse nor touch your wife passionately. But what the ulama do is that they have made the issue very flexible. They say that you have three actions: the stoning of the jamrah, the shaving of the head, and performing the tawaf al-ifadah, along with the sa'i if you have not performed it. So we'll put the tawaf and the sa'i in one category, or as one action. So in total now we have three actions. They say that if you do any two of these three, then this will be the first tahallul, and if you do all three, then this becomes the second tahallul. How do they argue? They argue by saying that the second tahallul would take place after the tawaf. So certainly the tawaf has an effect on your tahallul. And we're talking about the second tahallul. So if it has an effect on your second tahallul, then let it also have an effect on your first tahallul. So based upon this, if you were to, let's say, stone the jamrah and perform the tawaf along with the sa'i, if you have to, then you would have performed the first tahallul. So everything is halal for you except intercourse with your wife. And then when you shave your head, then absolutely everything becomes halal for you. So basically the first tahallul takes place when you perform any two of these three, and the second tahallul takes place when you perform all three of these. However, if you have brought along a sacrificial animal, Then it is a justifiable opinion to say that you firstly should sacrifice your animal before you shave the head, because the Prophet told one of his wives, فَلَا أَحِلُّ حَتَّى أَنْحَرُ. I will not become halal until I sacrifice the animal. So firstly, we would say that you should do it in that order. Sacrifice first and then shave the head. And secondly, we could say justifiably that you cannot completely be removed from the ihram until you have sacrificed. Whereas if you were doing your tamattu or the qiran and you had not brought along the sacrificial animal, then sacrificing the animal does not have an effect on your tahallul, neither the first nor the second. So we say for those who have brought along a sacrificial animal, by way of recommendation, we would say that you do not become completely halal until you have sacrificed your animal. As Allah says, وَلَا تَحْلِقُوا رُؤُوسَكُمْ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ الْهَدْيُ مَحِلَّ. And do not shave your heads until the animal reaches its place of sacrifice. Hadith 647. وعن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن العباس بن العبد المطلب استأذن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يبيت بمكة ليالي منى من أجل سقايته فأذن له. متفق عليه. From Ibn Umar, he said that Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib sought permission from the Prophet to spend the nights of Mina in Mecca, because he was giving the Hujjaj water to drink, and the Prophet granted him permission. Hadith 648. وعن عاصم بن عدي رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رخص لرعاء الإبل في البيتوتة عن منى يرمون يوم النحر ثم يرمون الغد ليومين ثم يرمون يوم النفر. رواه الخمسة وصححه الترمذي وابن حبان. From عاصم بن عدي, he says that the Prophet gave permission to the people looking after the camels to not stay the night at Mina. They would stone the Jamrah on the Yawm al-Nahr, then they would stone it on the 12th for the 11th and the 12th day, and they would stone it on the Yawm al-Nafr, the day when you depart. The narration is Sahih. So we find from the first of these two narrations that Al-Abbas is giving water to the Hujjaj, and he's doing this near the Kaaba. This was near the Hijr area, and the Quraysh would pride themselves in giving water to the Hujjaj, because this was a virtuous act. And Al-Abbas was one of those who was doing this. So he did not have to spend the nights of the Ayyam al-Tashriq, which are the 11th, 12th and 13th, in Mina. And because the Prophet has given him a rukhsa, which is the lightening of the load, it would therefore mean that anyone other than Al-Abbas has to spend the night in Mina, and that this would be wajib. Otherwise there would be no need to give a rukhsa. Al-Abbas would be giving the Hujjaj the water of Zamzam to drink. Hence we find therefore that staying the night at Mina during the days of Tashriq is from the wajibat of the Hajj. And if you do not do it, then you have to sacrifice an animal and feed it to the poor people of the Haram. He also gave the permission to those people who were looking after the camels, and this would be the sacrificial camels, that they did not need to spend the night at Mina. And one thing both of these jobs have in common is that they are serving the general population over there. Some scholars say it is only mustahab to stay the night at Mina, because what is required in Mina is for you to stone the jamarat on the Ayyam al-Tashriq, not necessarily staying the night there. However, what is apparent from the narration of Al-Abbas is that it is wajib, because a rukhsa was given. And a rukhsa is normally given for things which are wajib. But if it is wajib to stay the night at Mina, then we need to ask ourselves, what's the minimum amount that you have to stay in Mina? And the answer is that you have to spend most of the night at Mina, and that this is wajib. Otherwise, it does not hold true that you have spent the night at Mina if you did not spend most of the night over there. It's much the same ruling as staying the night at Al-Muzdalifah. You have to spend most of the night there, up until after the moon disappears. This is what Asma radiallahu anha did, as we mentioned before. And we need to note here that staying all of the nights of Tashriq in Mina is wajib. So if you missed out one night, but you spent the rest of the night in Mina, then there is no sacrificial animal for you. If you missed out on all of the nights at Mina, then there is a sacrificial animal. So you treat the nights of Mina as one action. So if you just missed out one night or two nights, there is nothing upon you, although you did not do well. But if you missed out all three of the nights of the Ayyam Tashriq in Mina, then you have to sacrifice an animal. So all of these three nights are counted as one action. The question is, can we make an analogy from these narrations and say that those soldiers or police officers who are performing Hajj, they can also not spend the night at Mina because of their duty? The answer is yes, we can make a sensible analogy, because these people who are working, they are working for the benefit of the whole population. Just like Al-Abbas was working for the people and the shepherds were working for the people to benefit them. And likewise, the soldiers or the police officers are working for the people, so they are also given this permission on the nights of Mina. So you could have soldiers, you could have doctors, police officers, or people working in hospitals. All of these people are given a permission. And this is a sensible analogy to make, and definitely the more practical view. Also, if somebody is ill, or he fears that his wealth may be lost if he spends the night in Mina, then these people are also given permission not to spend the night in Mina. Or perhaps if somebody has lost his child and he goes around searching for his child and this takes him the whole night, then he is excused also from spending the night at Mina. And there is no sin upon them and nothing to sacrifice. And this is what Ibn Qudama says in his book Al-Mughni, and is also the opinion of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. As for in the second narration, we learned something about the stoning of the Jamrah for those people who were tending the camels. On the Yawm al-Nahr, which is the 10th, they would stone the Jamrah al-Aqaba, just like everyone else does. Then they would not stone on the 11th, because they are tending the camels. But they would come back on the 12th, which is the Yawm al-Nafar al-Awwal, and they would stone all three of the Jamrat for the 11th and the current day, which is 12th. Because remember, they did not stone on the 11th. Then they would come back on the 13th, if they had not left the Hajj, and they would stone the Jamarat, all three of them, for the 13th. And it's because of this narration, some ulama say that even if you were to stone on the 13th for the 11th and the 12th and the 13th, then this would suffice you. But we mentioned this issue before, and we said that this will only be sufficient for somebody who has a valid reason to do so. Otherwise, you have to stone the three Jamarat in each of the successive days. And you cannot just save it all up for the last day, which is the 13th. Or the 12th, if you're going to leave on the 12th. So if somebody is staying very far away from the Jamarat and it will cause him difficulty to come back and return, then yes, he can save it up for the last day. Likewise, with somebody who is tending the camels, or is doing a similar job in which he is occupied with the general welfare of the people, then yes, again, he can combine between the stonings, just as the workers did here in this narration. Otherwise, the general rule is you have to stone the Jamarat on their respective days. And we also take from these narrations that stoning the Jamarat is wajib, because the Prophet did not give permission to the Ru'at, those who are tending the camels, to miss out on the stoning. The stoning needs to be carried out during the days of Tashriq. If you were to delay it until after the days of Tashriq, then you have missed out on the wajib act and you have to sacrifice an animal and feed it to the poor of the haram. Also, we can take from this narration that it is not permissible for you to appoint somebody to stone on your behalf. Because here we find that the Ru'at had to stone for themselves. It would have been easier, of course, if they appointed somebody to stone on their behalf because they were too busy tending the camels. But the Prophet did not allow this, and he ordered them to stone themselves. And from this it becomes known the error of those people who appoint a deputy to stone the Jamarat on their behalf. What about if a person is not physically able to stone the Jamarat? Maybe he's suffering an ailment. Then in this case he can appoint somebody to stone on his behalf. And we know that the Sahaba used to stone on behalf of the small children who were not able to stone themselves. But if that's the case, then we have another question. How does he stone? Does he stone on his behalf first, so the first, second and third Jamarat, and then he returns to the first one and begins all over again, first, second and third, for the person on behalf he is throwing? Or can he throw at the first Jamarat for himself and for the other person, then moves to the second one and throws for himself and for the other person, and the same thing for the third? Which way does he do it? There is a difference of opinion. Some scholars say that the stoning needs to be done one after the other. So the first Jamarah, second and third, one after the other in succession, just as you perform your wudu. So based upon this, you would have to stone all three of them for yourself, and then you would return back to the first one and then stone all three of these in succession on behalf of the one you are throwing. The other opinion is that it is permissible for you to stone the first Jamarah on behalf of yourself, and then the second set of throwing, meaning seven pebbles, on behalf of the one who has appointed you as his deputy. And you do the same thing with the second, and the same thing with the third. And this appears to be the correct opinion, and it is what is apparent from the actions of the Sahaba. they would throw on behalf of the children. And what is apparent is that they would do the first jamrah first, both for themselves and for the children, then move on to the second, and then move on to the third. And definitely this is more practical and less of a hassle. And so we should always try to opt for the easier opinion as long as it is halal. And we know that performing the Hajj, especially the stoning, is difficult as it is. So anything which makes life easier should be welcomed with open arms. As for the timing of the stoning of the Jamarat, then as for the Yawm al-Nahr, we know that the time begins until after the sunrise. And this is the preferred time, although there's a difference of opinion, and we mentioned this before. And the time for stoning goes all the way up to the Fajr of the next day. So it's a very flexible timing. As for the stoning the Jamarat on the Ayyam al-Tashriq, then the time begins from after the Zawal. And it is not permissible to do it before, because the Prophet intentionally stoned the Jamarat after the Zawal. He even did it before the Salat al-Dhuhr, which means he really intended stoning it after the Zawal. So it begins from after the Zawal and it runs all the way up until Fajr or dawn break the next day. So we can see it's a very long time indeed. And this is the case except for the 13th, because with the 13th, it runs up until the Maghrib, because with the Maghrib, the next day begins. Of course, the night comes before, so the 14th has begun. And you do not stone the Jamarat on the 14th. And this idea that you are allowed to stone the Jamarat on the Ayyam al-Tashriq by night time is the madhab of Abu Hanifa, Malik and al-Shafi'i. And this is correct because there's no evidence to say that you are not allowed to stone the Jamarat by night time. The opinion of Al-Imam Ahmad is that the timing stops at Maghrib, because with Maghrib the next day begins and you do not stone by night time. But the majority opinion is better and more flexible. And the Jamarat on the Ayyam al-Tashriq must be stoned on the proper days, and you do not combine between the stoning except if you have a valid reason, which we discussed before. Hadith 649. وعن أبي بكرة رضي الله عنه قال خطبنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم النحر. الحديث متفق عليه. From Abu Bakr, he says that the Prophet gave us a khutbah or a sermon on the Yawm al-Nahr, which is the 10th. Hadith 650. وعن سراء بنت نبهان رضي الله عنها قالت خطبنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم الرؤوس فقال أليس هذا أوسط أيام التشريق. الحديث رواه أبو داود بإسناد حسن. From سراء بنت نبهان, she says, the Prophet gave us a khutbah on the day of the heads. And he said, is this not the middle of the days of Tashriq? And the hadith goes on, and it is da'if. As for the Yawm al-Nahr, this is the 10th. As for the day of the heads, then this is the 11th of Dhul-Hijjah, because on this day they would eat the head of their sacrificed animal. And the 11th is also called the Yawm al-Qarr, the day when you are stationary, because nobody is going anywhere. Everybody must stay in Mina. It is only on the 12th when you are allowed to leave, after stoning the Jamar. So from these two narrations, we find that the Prophet gave a khutbah on the 10th and on the 11th. We also spoke about the fact that he gave a khutbah in Arafah, and we mentioned what he said back then. It needs to be noted that his khutbah on the Yawm al-Nahr, which is the 10th, was not the khutbah of the Salat al-Eid. Because of course we know that the Muslims elsewhere on this day are celebrating the Eid. And of course, after the Salat al-Eid, the Imam gives a khutbah. But this khutbah of the Prophet was not the khutbah of the Eid, because the Prophet did not pray Salat al-Eid when he was on the Hajj. And this khutbah was the Prophet giving the people some instructions about the Hajj and the rituals. And it also needs to be noted that the khutbah which he gave on Yawm Arafah, which happened on a Friday, was not the khutbah of Salat al-Jumu'ah, because the Prophet did not pray Salat al-Jumu'ah at Arafah. As is clearly stated in the narration, the Prophet gave the khutbah and then he combined between the Dhuhr and Asr. So he did not pray Salat al-Jumu'ah. Also needs to be noted that the Salat al-Jumu'ah is not combined with Salat al-Asr. Only the Dhuhr is combined. This is from the differences between al-Dhuhr and Salat al-Jumu'ah. So we can take from the narration that the Imam gives a khutbah on the Yawm al-Nahr and also on the Yawm al-Ru'us, in the same way he gives a khutbah on the day of Arafah. And this is in order to teach the people the rituals of the Hajj, and also to give them general guidance about things that they may need. For example, being patient, because this is something needed during the Hajj, and making dua and being regular in your dhikr and talbiyah, and anything else which the Imam feels that the congregation needs to know about. And we can take from this also that giving a khutbah during a time of mass congregation is a good idea, because then your message will reach a large number of people. And if we apply this idea to our present day situation, then we can justifiably say that the media that we have nowadays should be utilized in spreading the message of Al-Islam. And particularly during these days of the Yawm al-Nahr and the Yawm al-Arafah and the Yawm al-Ru'us, these are days in which the Muslims are likely to receive admonition, because they have come answering the call of Allah Jalla wa'ala, and they are in the mood to perform the worship. And they are likely, therefore, to be humble to receiving admonition and receiving the message. So the Imam needs to make full use of this situation. What he said on the 10th was that, "Verily your blood, your wealth and your honor are all haram upon you," meaning they are sacred and they are not allowed to be violated. Just like the sanctity of this day of yours, in this city of yours, and in this month of yours. "Behold, do not return as kuffar after me, striking each other's necks," meaning do not fight each other, as this is from the traits of the kuffar, fighting the Muslims. "O people, worship your Lord, and pray your five, and fast your month, and obey your Lord when He commands you, and you will enter the Jannah of your Lord. Behold, let the one who is present convey to the one who is not present, because many a time the one who receives the information understands it better than the one who first heard it. And perhaps I will not meet you after this day of mine. Behold, have I conveyed the message to you?" And they said, "Na'am, yes." And the Prophet said, "Allahumma ashhad, O Allah, bear witness to this." As for the khutbah on the 11th, what has been mentioned is that he said, "Do not oppress each other, and the wealth of a Muslim is not halal except by his own goodwill, and the riba of the days of Jahiliyyah is abrogated, and fear Allah concerning the women, because they are helpers to you. Verily they have rights over you, and you have rights over them, that they should not allow anyone to sit on your bed other than you, and they should not allow anyone into the house whom you dislike. And whoever has been entrusted by somebody, then let him render back his trust. O people, your Lord is one, and your Father is one. There is no virtue for an Arab over a non-Arab, nor a non-Arab has virtue over an Arab, nor the red person, meaning a white person, has virtue over a black person, nor a black person has virtue over a red person, meaning a white person, except when it comes to the taqwa of Allah. Meaning to say, people, on an individual scale, are only superior to other people on account of the taqwa, nothing else, neither skin color nor nationality. Abdurrahman ibn Mu'adh says, "The Prophet gave us a khutbah whilst we were in Mina, and our ears were opened and we heard what the Prophet was saying whilst we were in our places." So it appears then that the voice of the Prophet reached everybody in Mina, which seems to be somewhat impossible if you think about it, but Allah Jalla wa'ala is able to convey His message, and he's able to do things which are scientifically impossible. As for the Prophet saying, "Is this not the awsat of the days of Tashriq?" Then awsat could mean middle, but we know that the 11th is the first of the days of Tashriq. So some ulama say that awsat in this case means the best, so the best of the days of Tashriq. And the reason why this could be is because it follows the Yawm al-Nahr. So if you have not sacrificed the animal on the 10th, then it is most likely that you will do it on the 11th. Hence making the 11th more virtuous than the 12th and the 13th, in which there is no sacrifice being made. And Allah knows best. Hadith 651. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لها طوافك بالبيت وبين الصفا والمروة يكفيك لحجك وعمرتك. رواه مسلم. From Aisha, the Prophet told her that your tawaf around the house and between the Safa and Marwa will suffice you for your Hajj and your Umrah. Muslim reported it. So we take from this narration that Aisha was performing the Qiran, where you combine between the Hajj and the Umrah, and the actions you perform are the same as the Ifrad, except that you have to slaughter an animal, just as you would with the Tamattu'. And the reason why the Prophet told her this in this hadith is because she wanted to perform an independent Umrah after her Hajj. But the Prophet is telling her here that you don't need to perform an independent Umrah, because the tawaf which you performed around the house and between the Safa and Marwa, meaning the Sa'i, is enough for your Hajj and your Umrah. So you will go home with two rituals, the Hajj and the Umrah. But the point is that Aisha refused except to perform an independent Umrah after the Hajj. She could not do it before the Hajj because she was in her menstruation. So she could not perform the tawaf. Hence, she could not perform the Umrah. As for the tawaf al-ifada of the Hajj, then a menstruating woman still has to perform this after she finishes the menses. So she is allowed to delay it even after the days of Tashriq, and when she finishes the menses, she performs the tawaf al-ifada. And then she is completely removed from the ihram. Of course, if she needs to perform the sa'i, then she needs to do that as well before she is removed from the ihram. And we learn from this that if you're performing the Qur'an, then you only have to perform one tawaf and one sa'i, and you don't need to perform it twice. This is because the umrah is like a minor hajj, so these are two acts of worship which are of the same type. So the smaller one enters into the larger one, as the umrah enters into the hajj. And this is what Qur'an is all about, when you combine between the two. It's like if you are in a state of janaba, then obviously you need to perform a bath. But this bath of yours would suffice you for your hadith akbar and your hadith asghar. So you're allowed then, after this bath, to pray. And this is where you need to be removed from hadith asghar and hadith akbar. So if you take one bath and you make your intention that you are removing yourself from the hadith akbar and the hadith asghar, then this would suffice you. And we spoke about this in the book of purity or tahara. In the full version of this hadith, we find that Aisha was extremely upset when she found out that she was menstruating, because she knew she would not be able to perform the umrah, and she was crying. And the Prophet gave her solace. He said that this menstruation is something which Allah has ordained on the daughters of Adam. So he's telling her that you're not the only one who's suffering this, rather all women suffer this. So you do not need to feel so dispirited. And so this is a good idea. Whenever anyone is feeling depressed, you should grant them solace and try to make them feel happy. But we find from the narration that Aisha did not accept this, and she was adamant that she wanted to perform a separate umrah. And so the Prophet ordered her brother, Abdurrahman, to take her to the nearest Hill area, which is Tan'im. And from there she's going to enter the ihram and come into the Masjid al-Haram and perform the tawaf, because the idea of umrah is that it means ziyara or visit, and you can only visit when you come from outside the haram. So this is why you have to go into the hill and enter into the ihram. And this applies to anyone in Mecca who wants to perform the umrah, is that he has to go outside the haram and enter into the ihram from there. As for the hajj, then he can enter into the ihram from wherever he is, inside the haram even. Because we know during the hajj you have to go outside the haram because you have to stay at Arafah. So definitely you'll be coming into the haram to perform the tawaf from outside the haram. The Hanafiya say that if you're performing the Qur'an, you have to perform two tawafs around the Kaaba and two sa'is between the Safa and Marwa, one for the Hajj and one for the Umrah. But this hadith refutes that idea. The question now is, on the 10th, when you're performing the tawaf al-ifada, can you perform the sa'i before the tawaf? We have already discussed this issue, and we said yes, it can be performed before the tawaf al-ifada, and we have the authentic hadith in the Sunan, and we discussed this issue before. So if somebody is performing the Qiran or the Ifrad, and he did not have a chance to perform the Tawaf al-Qudum, and hence perform the Sa'i afterwards, and so we find that the first Tawaf he's going to perform is the Tawaf al-Ifada, then is he allowed to perform the Sa'i before the Tawaf al-Ifada? The answer, according to the correct opinion, is yes. As for the Umrah, you need to perform the Tawaf first and then the Sa'i. You are not allowed to rupture the order, because with the Umrah it's different, as there is only the Tawaf and the Sa'i to perform. Because after that you have your head shaved and you release from the Ihram. But as for the Hajj, there are many actions which you are performing, and so for you to do them in any order you want is first of all more practical, and secondly we have evidence from the authentic narrations, which we have discussed. And this hadith also shows us that the actions of the Umrah enter into the actions of the Hajj, as the Prophet said in the Sahih, دَخَلَتِ الْعُمْرَةُ فِي الْحَجِّ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. The Umrah has entered into the Hajj up until يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. What is the ruling on the Sa'i? There are three opinions on this. One opinion says it is mustahab, the other one says it is wajib, and the third opinion says it is from the arkan of the Hajj. And the opinion which we incline to in this presentation is that it is from the arkan of the Hajj. And we'll speak more about that later. And Ibn Qudama says in his book Al-Mughni that it is wajib, and he puts it on the same level as stoning the jamarat and shaving the head. It is wajib but not a rukn. Hadith 652. وَعَنِ ابْنِ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَمْ يَرْمُلْ فِي السَّبْعِ الَّذِي أَفَاضَ فِيهِ رواه الخمسة إلا الترمذي وصححه الحاكم From Ibn Abbas, he says that the Prophet did not make ramal in the 7 circuits of the Tawaf al-Ifadah. The narration is sahih. So this is clear evidence that the ramal is only to be done in the Tawaf al-Qudum, in the first 3 complete circuits. Also, if you're coming from outside the Haram and you're performing the Tamattu', then the ramal is done in the first 3 circuits for the Tawaf of the Umrah, because this takes the place of the Tawaf al-Qudum for the one who is performing the Qiran or the Ifrad. Of course, the Tawaf al-Qudum is for the one coming from outside the Haram. The ruling on Tawaf al-Qudum itself is that it is mustahab. As for the Tawaf of the Umrah, of course, it is wajib, because you can have no Umrah without this Tawaf. And so therefore, the Ramal and the Ittiba' is not done in the Tawaf al-Ifadah, because with this Tawaf, it is not the arrival Tawaf. Likewise, with the Tawaf al-Wada', the farewell Tawaf, you do not perform the Ramal nor the Ittiba', because with the Tawaf al-Wada', you are not arriving in Mecca, rather, you are leaving Mecca, which is the opposite. As for the reason for making Ramal and Ittiba', then we have spoken about this before. The Muslims were showing the Kuffar that they have strength, and they are not weakened by the fever which was prevalent in Al-Madina. And so when you make Al-Ittiba' and the Ramal, then you should have in your mind that you are imitating the companions, and it is as if you are enraging the Kuffar. Hadith 653. وعن أنس رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الظهر والعصر والمغرب والعشاء ثم رقد رقدة بالمحصب ثم ركب إلى البيت فطاف به. رواه البخاري. From Anas, he says that the Prophet prayed Salat al-Dhuhr and Asr and Maghrib and Isha, and then he slept a little while in a place called Al-Muhassab, and then he rode to the Kaaba and made Tawaf. Al-Bukhari reported it. Hadith 654. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها لم تكن تفعل ذلك أي النزول بالأبطح وتقول إنما نزله رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأنه كان منزلا أسمح لخروجه. رواه مسلم. From Aisha, it is stated that she would not do this, meaning stay at Al-Abtah, otherwise known as Al-Muhassab. And she says that the Prophet only stayed in Al-Muhassab or in Al-Abtah because it was easier for him to leave Mina and go to Mecca from there. Muslim reported it. The place Al-Muhassab is so called as it comes from the word Al-Hasba', which are small pebbles, and this is because this place has many small pebbles. As for nowadays, this place has become developed with tiles and cement and buildings around it, and it is in fact a very important trade market in Mecca. The scholars are agreed that after the Prophet stoned the Jamarat, after the Zawal on the 13th, he left Mina and made his way towards the Kaaba for the farewell Tawaf. But before entering the Masjid, he stayed in a place called Al-Abdah, or as it is called, Al-Muhassab, and he prayed Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib and Isha over there. And then he slept a little bit. After that, he rode on the camel and went to the Al-Masjid Al-Haram, and he performed the Salat al-Subh in the Masjid. He performed the Tawaf al-Wada', the farewell Tawaf over there, and then he travelled back to Al-Madina. The difference of opinion is this idea of staying in Al-Abdah. Is it an act of worship, or did the Prophet do it because it was just convenient for him to do so? According to the narration of Aisha, she says he only did it because it was more convenient, and we find from the narration that Aisha herself did not used to do this, as she did not deem it to be an act of worship. Most scholars say that it is virtuous to stay in Al-Abtah, as it's reported that Abu Bakr, Umar and Ibn Umar, they all used to do this. And some scholars say it is not sunnah, and there is no particular virtue in doing this. And Ibn Abbas said that this idea of staying at Al-Muhassab or Al-Abtah is nothing special. It is only a place in which the Prophet stopped. So it is not a legislated act of worship. And we can see that Aisha holds the same opinion. And from the Tabi'een, there were some eminent scholars who did not used to stay at Al-Muhassab. As for the scholars who say there is a virtue, they take their evidence from what has been reported in the Sahihain, reported from Abu Huraira. The Prophet said, نَحْنُ نَازِلُونَ غَدًا إِن شَاءَ اللَّهُ بِخَيْفِ بَنِي كِنَانَةَ حَيْثُ تَقَاسَمُوا عَلَى الْكُفْرِ. Tomorrow, inshaAllah, we will descend on the khayf of Banu Kinana. This is a tribe. And a khayf is that part of a mountain which is above the lower land, which is normally flooded, and it is below the rough side of the mountain. And so he says, we will descend at this place of Banu Kinana, where they took an oath on Kufr. And what he's referring to here is that Banu Kinana and the tribe of Quraysh, they both took an oath of allegiance that they will cut off relationships with Banu Hashim and the tribe of Banu al-Muttalib, that they will not intermarry and they will not conduct business transactions until Banu Hashim deliver the Prophet to the Quraysh. But of course Allah Jalla wa Ala foiled their plot. So it appears now that the Prophet is descending on this place as a symbolic gesture that Islam has overcome kufr. So these ulama say that as a symbolic gesture, it is also legislated for us to stay in this place to display that Islam overcame kufr. But for certain we can say it is not wajib. This is due to the narration in Sahih Muslim. Abu Rafi', the freed servant of the Prophet, says that the Prophet did not order me to stay at Al-Abdah. Rather, I was the one who set up a tent for him over there. So if somebody was to deliberately miss out not staying at Al-Abdah, then there is no sin upon him and he does not have to do anything. And if he does stay at Al-Abdah in imitation of the Prophet, then we hope that he will be rewarded for his imitating the Prophet. Let us take some review questions. So question number one. What was the order of the Prophet in leaving the Ihram? And then thereafter, give the evidence which tells us that this order is not an obligation, but rather at most a recommendation. Question number two. Which type of people do not need to spend the night at Mina? And also, which types of people are allowed to combine the stoning of Jamarat on the Ayyam al-Tashriq? Question number three. If you are unable to stone the Jamarat on the Ayyam al-Tashriq and you appoint a proxy, then how would the proxy stone the Jamarat?